gloves on, like those finger cut out gloves.
Yeah, because you can still get kind of like articulation, but your like base hits, you're not beating yourself up.
Yep, because I had it where I played once for like 2 hours outdoors. Oh yeah, so like I remember like my fingers were like just cracking all over the place. I was like, yeah, this is
right.
This is no bueno.
You got your ears if you need them, I don't know if you need them. I put your sticks next to you. All right. All right, good morning, Washington Church. I'm going to invite you to stand and join us in the call to worship. How great is our God! How awesome are your deeds! Lord, you are gracious and compassionate. You are my rock, my shield, and my fortress. Therefore, we will sing your praises and speak of your goodness. Jesus, you are worthy of all worship and praise. Reveal yourself to us. At this time, I'm going to invite you to greet others around you. And kids, come on forward for the kids' message.
Perfect. Nice. All right, everybody. Am I good? A little higher. There you go. Hello. Hello. Good morning, Washington Church. Good morning, friends. How are you guys doing? Are you really? Okay, good. All right, well, we're here this morning to talk about something that I still don't fully understand. So I'm going to try to help you understand it. But if I don't understand it, I don't know if I'm going to do a good job. So bear with me, okay? I'm going to do my best. So does anybody know, what does the word discipline mean? Okay, this is a hard word, so it's okay. If you disobey, there might be discipline. Okay, consequence, that's a great word. Anybody else have anything else that they want to add? What is discipline? Has your mom ever told you, hey, don't run in the street because there's what? Why doesn't your mom want you to go in the street? Because there's cars. So maybe you get told to do something, but there's a reason why, right? There's a reason because it might keep you safe. It might make something better. And maybe you don't understand that right at the time. So right now as a congregation, we're talking about spiritual disciplines. So these are things that we work on that help us grow spiritually. They help us grow closer to God. So the spiritual discipline that we're talking about today is called fasting. And fasting still doesn't make a lot of sense to me. So that's why I said we're going to learn to do it together. So I thought of this. I feel like God gave me this. Everyone, let's hold out one hand like this. So hold out one hand. You guys can all do this too. So now as I read a verse that said, it's in Matthew, it says, your Father who is in heaven will give good things to those who come to him. So our God wants to give us good gifts. He wants to give us good things. As we talk, I want you guys to think of some things that take up your time. Think of some things that you spend time doing. Who spends time playing with their friends? close one finger. If you spend time playing with your friends, close your one finger. If you spend, who spends time going to school or work? Let's close another finger. Who spends time eating food? Close one finger. All right. What about who plays any sports? Who plays a sport or plays an instrument? Close another finger. Who just likes to sit around on their phone or play video games or watch a TV show? That's another one. So everyone's hand is closed, right? We have a lot of things that we spend time doing. So if I wanted to come give you a good gift, everyone has their hand closed like this, right? If I wanted to give you something, you can't get it, right? It's hard to receive when your hand's closed. So fasting is an idea that we give up some of those things that we do every day. So maybe we give up a little bit of our time watching TV shows. Or maybe we give up a meal. Or maybe we, instead of eating, we go spend time with Jesus. Or maybe we give up school one day and we just hang out with God all day. Anybody want to do that? That sounds fun, right? So, fasting is a way that we can all learn to take all the things that we hold really tightly and that come in between us and time with God, and we give those up so that when God, like we hear in this verse, wants to give us good gifts, that we have open hands to receive them. Okay? So let's bow our heads, and we're just going to ask God to help us to have open hands. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much for not understanding things fully. Thank you for walking through things with the children and just getting to look at them in a simpler way. Lord, I pray that we would stop and think and let you search our hearts for things that we close our hands around too tightly, things that we spend too much time doing, and things that you're asking us to give up in space to give you more space in our life. God, would you just come and dwell in the hearts of these young children and the rest of this congregation? And would we make time for you? Would we be willing to surrender so that we can have the good gifts that you promised to give us? And all God's children said, thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right, y'all. Adios. Took off one hat, put on the other. Here we go. All right, I'm here to do announcements. Good morning, Washington Church, again. Thank you for going through that with me and the youngins. So welcome to everybody here. Welcome to any new people that I may not know. Welcome to all the friendly faces that I've seen plenty of times. It's always good to hang out with you guys on Sunday mornings and any other day. Also, welcome to anybody that's online joining us. We're so happy that we have this available and that we can gather this way. First thing, as always, if you are looking to give to Washington Church, we have the old-fashioned giving boxes at both of the entrances. You can just slide a check or anything in those. We also have the option to give at washingtonchurch.org/give or on your bulletin. There is a QR code at the bottom that you can follow to give there as well. There are name tags at the front, magnetized to that board up there. If you do not have a name tag, over by the giving boxes, there's actually temporary name tags. You can make yourself one. And also, if you would like a name tag, you plan on being here at Washington pretty consistently, we'd love that you had a name tag so we can call you by name. So if you want to write on your little connection card, hey, I need a name tag, and then write your name and put that in the offering, we'll get you a name tag made so you have a cool printed official one. We are having a connection event today right after service. So if you're newer to Washington or you're looking for any ways that you could get connected, just join us for this event. It shouldn't be too crazy, shouldn't be too long. This is just a great opportunity to meet the staff, kind of hear about our vision, hear of the things that we're doing here at Washington Church, maybe some ways you can serve and be a part of this community. Because of the weather yesterday, the churchyard cleanup was pushed to Saturday the 29th, which is this next Saturday, right? From 9 a.m. to 12. So join as we clean up the outside space for the spring. We're just doing some spring cleaning, some lawn work. So if you would love to join us, bring some rakes, bring your clippers, anything that you feel like we might need to use. We would love to have, that's just another great time to gather in community and also get some much needed work done. If you have any questions about the churchyard cleanup, please contact Susan Gruel or the church office. And lastly, there will be a fundraiser for the Washington mission team that is headed to Kenya this summer. So on April 30th, so next Sunday after service in the fellowship hall, so downstairs, they are going to, they're having pizza and ice cream. Awesome. So yeah, just kind of a place where we can gather again in community, hear more about what they're going to be doing, and then find a way to support them, whether that's financially or maybe that's in encouragement, maybe that's in prayer. But we are super excited to support our mission team to Kenya. Come next Sunday after service. Plan on hanging out afterwards, get some lunch, and we can support our mission team. And next, I believe we have a child dedication. Another one. Nice. Look at all these childrens.
Here, I'll take that. Thanks. Good morning, everybody. Good to be with you this morning. We had the privilege of having two families that are having kids dedicated, Dominic and Mariah and Kelly and Corey. Would you guys come up and join us? Yep, come on up. Yeah, so at Washington Church, families are taken through a process where they learn about what it means to be a godly parent and the responsibilities that come with leading their families and being Jesus, essentially, to their children and exposing them to the gospel and praying for them and leading them unto the Lord. And so as they were studying, we went through a passage in Deuteronomy 6, and which really talks about a core value system of what the Lord wants for parents and how they're supposed to function and act. And then they were challenged to commit to these four things, which we're going to talk through. And then you as the community is going to stand with them and commit in covenant to them. Do we have those slides, Bridge? All right. Can we put the Deuteronomy 6? So I'm going to read this just over them, and then we're going to go into those questions. It says this, "And you must commit yourself wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you are at home and when you are on the road, when you are going to bed, and when you are getting up." So this is a beautiful passage that just illustrates God's design and plan for parents to be the primary teachers to their children of the faith. And Washington as a church is a community that comes around them and supports them, but as parents, that's their primary role, is to instill faith in their children. And so we're going to put these questions up, and we're going to invite you to say yes as parents into this. It's okay, I can be way louder than Selah. I'm good. I got a mic. She doesn't. Yeah, I'm good. "Do you recognize this child as a gift of God and give heartfelt thanks for God's blessing? If so, say we do. All right. "Do you promise to instruct your child in the word of God and by precept and example bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? If so, say we do.
We do.
"Do you promise to regularly bring your child to the house of God to the end that they will develop a love for Christ and his church and for his word? If so, say we do.
We do.
All right. Now, we have a community, communal. So I want to invite you to stand and speak this over these families. If this is not something you can commit to, that's okay. I would just ask you not to say it. But I invite you to say this together as a church coming around them. So would you join me? "We, the people of Washington Church, receive this child into our love and care, and we promise as brothers and sisters in Christ to encourage and support you as parents in the fulfillment of your covenant. Amen. Please be seated. All right. I think we're starting with you guys. Sounds good. So I want to invite the family members to come on up and stand behind them and stand with them. And as they come up, each of the parents were asked to partner together and to write or come up with a life verse for Selah. And so we're going to hear that life verse and why they chose it. And then the fathers were asked to pray a blessing over their children. And so that's what we're going to do. All right?
All right. It's more of a life passage, actually. It's Colossians 3:14-17. And it says, above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. Let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all the wisdom he gives. Sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you say or do, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. We just, above all, we hope and pray that Selah knows her father's heart deeply, and that she desires closeness with her, and that we desire closeness with her as she journeys with him. And that the closer that she gets to God, the more evident these things in this passage are in her life as she grows. Yeah, in trade.
All right, if you bow your heads. Abba, Father, you are Lord. We come here to serve you and to commit Selah to you. I ask that Selah would live a life filled with joy during great times, during bad times, that during those trials or successes that she would respond with worship to you. May she know that you are with her. May she know that you are real and alive and always by her side. May she live a life that is sacrificial for others, just as you lived a life that was sacrificial for us. May she practice self-discipline, denying herself to the earthly pleasures, to live by the Holy Spirit. And above all else, may she know you and seek your voice and know your voice. We know that you are a good God. We dedicate Selah to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
All right, Selah. Okay. Here we go. Yeah, we'll stay real close to mommy.
It's okay.
It's okay, it's okay, sweetie. Oh, I'm sorry. I can have that effect on people. I know. I don't know if you guys know, but Selah is Hebrew, and you see it in the Psalms written in the pages like a script, and it means to raise up or to lift up. But it's also they use it as like a pause, like pause and reflect on what you're about to read is what the Hebrew scribes would write in there when they'd write Selah in there, Selah. And so Selah, what I saw when I heard your mom speaking over you was I saw this image of piano keys. And so I believe that you are going to lead people in worship in some way, and you're going to bring people into the presence of God. And the hearts are going to be changed because of your heart and your love for God. So, Selah, we dedicate you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks. All right, I want to invite the Burns and all that came with the Burns to come on up here and stand with Kelly and Corey as we dedicate Liberty. So you're here again, a life verse spoken, and then a prayer of blessing spoken over Liberty.
All right, y'all, my heart is so full this morning. If you would have told, you want me to step where?
Nope, you're good.
Okay. If you would have told me when I was sitting next to my boyfriend, Corey, right where RJ is sitting in 2013, that we would be up here dedicating our firstborn daughter today, I would not have even believed them. I am seriously so, so, so excited. So I had to write down what I'm going to say today so I don't tell you all the stories of how faithful and kind God has been. But you could come see me later if you want to hear him. So the Bible passage that we took Liberty Joy's name from is Isaiah 61. The whole passage is chock full of good stuff, but the life verse that we've chosen for her is Isaiah 61:1 that says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound." This is the same verse that Jesus proclaimed at the beginning of his ministry in the Gospel of Luke. And our hope is that Liberty will choose to walk in her Savior's footsteps, to do what he did, and to bring the kingdom of God wherever she goes. Our desire in naming you with the blessing Liberty Joy is that you would be free in the freedom that Christ alone purchased and provides, and that joy would be your portion in his presence.
Pray with me. Liberty, your mother and I bless you in the name of Jesus. You're a beloved daughter, and we take delight in you. We bless you as a burn, which means you are blessed to have fun with God and be a blessing to others. We will train you up. We will teach you the ways of God. We will help you to know him and be known by him, and we will be your mom and dad. I bless you with my protection, my strength, my favor, and my love. May you be blessed with a life of freedom and joy, as is your namesake. May you be blessed with strength through the power of God. May you be blessed with peace, abounding in hope through the Holy Spirit. Liberty, know that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. May the Lord increase in you that which I see in you as your dad. Your joy and fun-loving nature, your inquisitive spirit, and your love. Liberty, I bless you with truth. Your life will be strong and courageous. You will tread on fear, for your God will be with you wherever you go. Amen.
Hi. Hello. Hello. Here's Liberty. Liberty, that you have a big name to live up to, that you were given. And I think the Lord wants to invite you into that. What I saw, Liberty, when I prayed for you, as I saw you standing on the edge of high places, and that you will bring people to those places and help to set them free. So may you live into that. In Jesus' name, I dedicate you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'll take this from you. Thanks.
These babies were really excited to get dedicated today, that's for sure. Hey, I'm going to invite you to stand as we continue in worship. And just as a reminder, as always, the prayer team is available for you. The prayer team is available to you this morning. Whatever your need is, they're there to bring it before the feet of Jesus with you. And we just believe that the church is a house of prayer, and that's what we're here for. We're here to receive freedom and healing and to glorify and magnify the Lord together. So don't be ashamed, don't be afraid to go receive prayer this morning. wages of my sin was death. You knew I couldn't pay the debt. You paid it with your final breath. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. You took the wrath that I deserved.
Thank you.
Jesus, we thank you that you satisfy. That you satisfy our every need. That you satisfy more than our every need. That you satisfy our every desire. That when we delight ourselves in you, that we will find the desires of our heart, that you will reveal to us, that you will reveal to us the heart of the Father. So Jesus, we just thank you today for who you are. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you chase us down. So, Father, we just ask for more of your Spirit in this place. We're asking and we're crying out for more of you. Father, today we humble ourselves and we submit ourselves to you. We submit ourselves to your word, to your teaching. Open our hearts. Holy Spirit, would you open deaf ears today? Would you soften hearts that have been hardened so that we can hear your word and that it will cut to our soul, cut to our spirit, that we can leave this place different than we came in. We thank you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, if you got your Bibles, open up with me to Matthew chapter 6. That's where we're going to start this morning. We're going to kind of be all over the place. And as Pat said to the kids, we're talking about something that probably doesn't get talked about near enough in the church. There it is, Matthew 6. And what I want to do is just kind of open up the scriptures and teach from God's word and just kind of show what the text has to say about this topic, and then kind of invite us into a practice of fasting. So we're going to talk about fasting this morning, but by no means do I feel like I can stand, much like Pat, do I feel like I can stand up here and with authority talk about fasting. But what I want to do is I want to tell you about my own story of fasting and how it's been about 8 years now that I've integrated that into my life on a regular basis, and the fruit that's come from that for me. And then I want to show you just what God's word has to say about fasting and kind of four major principles. There's more than that, but four is enough for us this morning. But my desire is that it would pique your interest, that you would be drawn into this discipline and begin to recognize its value and the fruit that it has and that it offers us. Spiritual disciplines are what we've been talking about. So if you're visiting with us this morning for the child dedication, we're glad that you're here. We've been talking through a series of spiritual disciplines. Spiritual disciplines are things that have been around for thousands of years in the church. And the point of spiritual disciplines is to make us ready to steward the presence of God. That's the primary purpose of spiritual disciplines. It is to posture ourselves in such a way that we can be more open to God and be more receptive to what the Lord has for us, okay? And so that's why we're talking about this, is we've experienced our own movements of God here in this church, in this congregation. A summer ago, as we met as a staff, the idea came up to talk about spiritual disciplines. I thought it was a fabulous idea, and so that's what we've been doing. We've been journeying through that, basically through the winter into the spring. And we'll finish through May talking about spiritual disciplines. But this morning, we're going to talk about fasting. So about 8 years ago, I started fasting on Sunday mornings as just to be more, make myself more available to the Lord as I come to worship, but also to minister to God's people. And it has been a practice that I've observed. And what do I mean by that? That means I don't eat. So I'll drink liquids, but I don't eat. And so I started that 8 years ago, and I would fast through worship, and then I'd usually break my fast at lunch, and so really not that big of a deal, but it became a routine for me that became very life-giving, and I actually really looked forward to it, and every Sunday morning, looking forward to it, and I can tell you that if you're fasting with a purpose, like you have something in mind or something that's going on, it becomes very easy to fast. Because the Lord carries you in that to do the work that he has for you. And so I did that. I was reading at some point, working on a book project and studying on fasting more, and I came across a quote, I think it was from Jonathan Edwards, that said, I would not allow anyone in my church to become an elder unless they fasted at least twice a week. And I was like, oh, well, I couldn't qualify to be a church or an elder in Jonathan Edwards' church. Maybe I can anyway, but I was like, well, maybe twice a week is a good idea. And so I picked up another day. I was like, well, why not? Let's add another day. So I started fasting on Wednesdays, all the entire day on Wednesdays. And in the writings, he actually qualified from like 8 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock at night. There's been times where I'll eat dinner with my family just because I'm hungry and I want to eat dinner. I added another Wednesday, and that became a routine of mine probably about, I don't know, 3-4 years ago. And then I moved from that into when we started doing these encounter nights on Sunday nights, these awesome expressions of experiencing the Lord, I decided to extend my Sunday fast through the entirety of the day to fast into those worship spaces and those encounters. And so I then had 2 full days I was doing. And then our core group that I met with, we talked about fasting way early on in our time together, and we challenged each other to fast on Thursdays. And I said, well, let's try this, let's fast. And they're like, well, let's fast on Thursdays. And I was like, I already fast on Wednesdays. So I decided and we meet every other week, so I decided when my core group meets, I'm going to fast on Wednesday and Thursday of that week. And so those are just rhythms that I've picked up, and then we break our fast together at dinner. And that's been a wonderful thing. And I look forward to those weeks, and it's really fascinating because fasting exposes a lot of things. I'll tell you that. And one of the things that fasting has exposed to me is I have a very interesting relationship with food. I like it a lot. And I had no idea how much I liked it until I stopped giving it to myself. And then I was like, wow, there might be a thing here between food and I that needs to be dealt with. And so fasting has really transformed my view of food, because the next day when I wake up after fasting, like, food is amazing. I was like, wow, I really appreciate food even more. And so there's different things that I've learned through, and I'm going to share some of those with you. But we're going to start in Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to start at verse 5. This is right in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus is teaching on, and he begins to teach on prayer, and he says this, "And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." Okay? So he goes on and talk about prayer more and more, but there's a phrase in there. Go back and leave that slide up. So he starts by saying, "And when you pray." Okay? So Jesus is preaching to crowds, big crowds, but he's also talking to his disciples, his followers. So when he uses a line like, "When you pray," what do you assume that Jesus assumes about prayer? That what? That you're doing it. Right? Can we all on the same page with that? So when you pray, not if you pray, or if you happen to pray, or at some point when you pray, it's, no, when you pray, as in an ongoing assumption that you're praying. Is that fair? Okay. And then after this, he goes into the Lord's Prayer, which is really the prayer he teaches his disciples how to pray. And then after that, we go down to verse 16, and he says this, "When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face." So is it safe to say that if Jesus assumes we are praying when he says, "When you pray," what can we assume when he says, "When you fast"? That you're fasting. I didn't hear you. Yeah. So according to the scriptures, my understanding is that Jesus is assuming his followers are fasting. in the same regard that he's assuming his followers are praying. And all of us would be like, yeah, prayer's a good idea. I need to, probably more of us are like, yeah, I need to do more of that. You're right, Pastor Jimmy, I'll get out right on that. But when we say, when you fast, you're like, not sure about that not eating thing. But it's important as we look at God's word to say, like, okay, this is what it says. All right, so our posture should be not, how do I get around this? Or in one point, we'd be like, oh, this is the Old Testament. That's the Old Testament. But this is not the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. And so we can't pull that card out and play that one. And so we have Jesus saying to his followers, you should be fasting. This should be a normal part of your life. In the same way that prayer is a normal part of your life, fasting should be a normal part of your life. And I would go on to say even greater, that he, in this way, merges prayer and fasting together. And so, and oftentimes, I'm going to take you through several scripture passages, and there's a direct correlation between prayer and fasting and wanting to see God move in your life. Those two things coincide with each other. So you can pray without fasting, but I guarantee you right now, you can't fast without praying. Try it. It's like testing in schools. As long as there's tests in schools, there'll be prayer in schools. As long as people of God are fasting, they'll be praying. Because you need the Lord to get you through the day when you aren't eating. But yet, where do you want to be? Really, at the end of the day, that's when I think about fasting, that becomes the question for me. It's like, where do you want to be? Because I don't know about you, but I can live most of my days and most of my life not relying on God, if I'm honest. My cupboards are stocked. I got plenty of food. I have enough finances to make it through the next couple days. I'll be all right. I have a vehicle. I have a home that I live in. In many ways, I don't need to rely on God. I just don't. And we've set up a culture where that's kind of how we live. We don't really want to rely on God. We want to be taken care of. We want to feel safe. And this is human nature. Okay? No harm, no foul. It's just what it is. When you begin to deprive yourself of the very thing that you need, you got to rely on God. Fasting causes you to rely on God like nothing else will. This is why we fast. This is why we're invited to fast. But probably for the majority of Christians, it's a discipline that's not practiced because it's hard. It's not easy. It's very challenging to do it. But in the same way, it's extremely rewarding and a beautiful experience. So the first point I have for you is this, that fasting humbles us. Okay? I guarantee when you begin to not eat, you will be humbled. Why is that important? Because God's appointed way to humble ourselves is with us stepping into that and removing food. When we do that, we come against something that is very instinctual in us as human beings. That is pride. When you fast, your pride is revealed. It comes to the surface. And what is pride? Pride is really believing that you can do it all yourself, utter confidence in yourself. And what happens when you remove food is that you begin to reveal the things that control you in your life. They come to the surface very quickly, especially on day one. And I'll tell you about that in more detail as we get there. But we cover up a lot of things with food in our lives. Okay, and those things come to the surface when we begin to fast. When you deprive your body of food, you become weaker and you become more reliant on the Lord. And you literally are humbling yourself. Okay, I want to show you a couple scriptures about humility. The first is in James chapter 4. It says this, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. So it's good to humble ourselves. That's a good thing. James 4:6 says this, God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. So again, pride is something we all carry with us. We all need to deal with. We need that to be dealt with. The Lord needs to deal with the pride in our lives. I have pride. We all have pride. It's in places sometimes we don't even recognize. But when we choose to willingly put ourselves in a place where we weaken ourselves, our pride begins to go out the window because we can't do things on our own. When we can't do things on our own, we have to rely on the Lord. And we have to rely on the Lord, that is like a sweet spot to be in. It's a gift to be in that place. And in our culture, it becomes harder and harder to put ourselves in that place from time to time. You cannot get close to God with pride, and humility deals with pride. And one of the best ways to humble ourselves is through fasting. Psalm 35:13 says, "Yet when they were ill, I put on sackcloth and humbled myself with fasting, when my prayers returned to me unanswered." So essentially what the psalmist is saying is when he was praying and praying and nothing, there was no movement of the Lord, he began to add fasting to his prayer in order to hear a response from God. Another verse, Psalm 69:10, "When I humbled my soul with fasting." So we see a direct correlation between humility and fasting in the scriptures. And it's a beautiful and powerful thing. And it also comes against the pride in our life. So that's number one. Number two, fasting causes us to rely on the Lord. It just plain and simple does. And the question becomes, do we want to be people that have to rely on God? Right? And that's not an easy question to answer, because there's a lot of letting go that has to happen for us to rely on the Lord. Let me kind of walk you through what fasting looks like, just to entice you to get excited about it. Okay? Fasting on day one is the hardest. Day one is literally the hardest. When I do, there's somebody else on my staff that fasts on a regular basis, and we have chats back and forth because we share an office. And I shared with her once, I was like, "Yeah, I'm fasting one day a week." And she's like, "Why would you do that? That sucks." She's like, "That's the hardest. You just keep doing the hardest thing over and over again." I was like, "That's a good point." So that's one of the reasons why I added a second day. So fasting on the first day, it's when your body will feel pain and discomfort. But this is not real hunger. Your stomach has been trained and conditioned through the years to give you signals of hunger and at certain hours of the day. You'll feel weak and tired at various times during the day. Your body will act like a spoiled child. Okay, this is from Richard Foster's book, The Celebration of Discipline, which is absolutely fabulous. If you've not read it, buy it. I think it's one of the top Christian books of all time, I would say. A must read several times throughout your life. But I love this image of a spoiled child, because what does a spoiled child do when they don't get their way? What? Whine? What else? Throw a fit? Cry? Ask for attention in some way? And I love that Foster uses this analogy of, like, when you fast on day one, you're like a spoiled child. And I'm telling you this so that when you get there, you'll be prepared. Okay? That it's coming. Those who decide to step into this, and I hope you all do, because again, it's a beautiful and powerful thing to do. But what we have to realize as parents, right, of children who act spoiled or don't get what they want, you know, like, you're fine. You know, how many of you guys know, if you have parents of little kids, there's different tones of cries that you have to worry about? And there's some cries where you're like, uh-oh, we might be going to the ER. And then there's other cries where you're like, you're actually fine. We just got to work through this. You know what I'm talking about? Can I get an amen? Okay, you're with me. And so that's what happens with your body. Your body reacts because your body is attuned to functioning in a certain way. And when it doesn't get what it wants, it lets you know about that. And it actually physically throws a fit. And you don't feel good. And you're sometimes, I've had times when I've had headaches before. That's not super common for me, but you can feel lethargic. But I've gotten to a point where I've fasted for several years now, and I just know what that's like. And when the spoiled child starts to come up, I just give it the eye, and it goes, all right, fine. I know I'm not going to get anywhere. You're not going to respond to me. And so it just goes away very quickly. So day one is not as hard as it used to be for me. But your body can go up to 40 days without needing food. 40 days plus. So one day isn't that big a deal in the grand scheme of things. Actually, it's not until you get into your 20th or so day of fasting that your body goes into starvation mode. So you can go almost 20 days of fasting until, like, your body's like, oh no, we got a problem. And how amazing it is that God created us this way. The body's an absolutely amazing thing. I mean, if talk to Jay or other doctors here, Tim, they'll tell you, like, how fascinating and amazing the body is. But one of the things that the body can do, I will tell you with great authority, you can go without eating for a day, and you will survive. You will live, and you will be fine. Actually, you'll benefit from it. When it gets to day two, things actually level out, and the spoiled child gives up. And so day two is actually an enjoyable experience, which sounds really strange. It seems like day one would be easier than day two and the farther you get, but the longer you get into it, it actually becomes more and more enjoyable. And you actually hit a point where you are like on cruise control, and it's just very, very strange to just not eat. Because we're around food. Food is such a major part of our lives. Like, you don't realize it until you don't eat. And then you'll realize how big it is as a part of your life. But you get into this mode where you're just like, oh, I'm fine. And you realize, like, I'm just fine. Like, and I drink liquids. I have tea in the morning. That's my thing while I fast. But day two and day three oftentimes are great experiences. There's just a flow to it. And the only thing I've done is a five-day fast. That's the longest I've done. And so, again, I'm not an authority figure on fasting. I've done that several times. Every time I've done it, it's been a gift, a beautiful thing. The last time I did it was leading up to Easter, just fasting and praying for you all and for life and for God to move. And that was the desire behind it. There was a day on day four. That was Saturday morning. I woke up, and I felt terrible. It was a hard morning. It was really rough. And I was weak. I was lethargic. I felt like I could barely get out of bed. And I introduced some juice into my system to kind of level things out. And by 11 o'clock, I felt fine. And then day five was like amazing. And it was such a gift. But I'm gonna give you some examples that fasting causes us to rely on the Lord. There's an awesome story in the book of Esther, and I encourage you to read the entire story. But essentially, what's happening is Esther is the queen, but she's an Israelite. And there's a threat of killing all the Israelites. And so she comes before the Lord, and she prays and she fasts for a three-day period. And she asks everybody, she calls all of Israel to fast together. And they do that. And God answers them and gives a way forward for them to preserve them and to save them. But I love this image of an example of a three-day fast. Do not eat or drink for 3 days. So they came before the Lord with fasting and praying, and the Lord answered their prayer. There's another verse in Ezra, and where Ezra is wanting to go back and to rebuild the temple, and he's longing for a safe passage, and so he reaches out, and he says, I proclaimed a fast so that we might humble ourselves. Again, you see the link between humility and fasting. Humble ourselves before our God and ask him for a safe journey for us and our children with all of our possessions. Verse 23, so we fasted and petitioned our God about this, and he answered our prayer. And so again, there's something about fasting and praying that stirs the heart of God and brings a response from God in a different way than just praying does, okay? And I think in part because we humble ourselves and we come before the Lord. The third thing I want us to learn about fasting is that fasting prepares us to receive what the Lord has for us and enables us to hear from the Lord. So fasting prepares us to receive what the Lord has for us, okay? God wants to give us things, and the Lord wants to use us, but God wants people who position themselves in such a way that they can handle and receive what the Lord has to give. Because God knows what we can handle and the Lord knows what we can't handle. And so he gives us what we can handle with his aid. Not just what we can handle, because we can't handle much. But he gives us what we can handle with him walking alongside us. And fasting prepares us to handle that and to receive that in a greater measure. I'll give you some examples. One of the best examples is the prophet Anna. She's waiting in the temple. This is from Luke chapter 2, verse 37. So Anna is this spectacular woman. She's a prophet. She's hanging out and she's waiting to see the redemption of God, to see the Messiah come. So she's in the temple and she's in there, and we're told that she worshiped night and day and she with fasting and praying. So this is a posture that Anna takes in her life, because she knows that the Lord's going to reveal something to her, and so she uses fasting and praying to ready herself to receive what the Lord has. And then we know the story of Jesus. He's brought in for the dedication, just like we did this morning, into the temple, and then she recognizes him. Why? Because she's preparing herself, and she had been preparing herself to receive what God had for her, and fasting and praying and worshiping enabled her to see what the Lord had. Now, there's two different, I would say, not types of fasting, but modes of fasting that are important for us to realize. This is the first, and that is a fasted lifestyle. Okay, so she had a fasted lifestyle in which she engaged in fasting on a regular basis so that she'd be ready at any moment and any time to be used by the Lord and to receive what God had for her. Okay? Does that make sense? The other is fasting for a time, for a designated purpose, and for a reason. That's what we saw in Esther, right? We're fasting for a three-day period to hear from the Lord about this thing. So there's really two different ways of looking at fasting, and it's not one or the other, it's both and. But I can tell you, I fasted for periods, for purposes, but I'd never fasted on an ongoing basis before in my life. And what fasting or integrating a fasted lifestyle does is it really prepares your heart on a regular basis to receive what the Lord has. And those things could come out of nowhere because God says, okay, now you can handle these things. And so that's what's taking place here. Other examples. In the book of Acts, we see worshiping and fasting are combined in Acts 13:2. Okay? We see worshiping and fasting. The church is doing that together. And then the Lord speaks and he says, set apart Barnabas and Saul, or Paul, to do the work which I have called them. So again, they were able to receive from the Lord because of their fasting and prayer and worship that they were doing. And the Lord spoke to them to commission Saul and Barnabas, or Paul, to go and do the work. And then later on in the book of Acts, we see farther down that Paul and Barnabas go out and do that work, and they're planting churches, and the gospel is growing and thriving. But what they need to do in those churches, they'd come to the place, they'd stay for months or they'd stay for years, and they'd equip the church, they'd bring it together, and then they need to put leadership around that church because they knew they were leaving and going on. And the way they put leadership around that church and selected the elders for that church is they fasted and they prayed. And the Lord told them who to select as elders, and they laid hands on those people and they commissioned them. So we see again that the Lord enables us to hear what he has to say when we do that, when we engage in fasting. Right? Then there's radical examples of fasting where those principles take place. And you guys have probably heard these stories, but I'll put this up there anyway. Jesus fasts for a 40-day period before he begins his ministry. And in that time of fasting, it says the angels ministered to him. And it says that that the devil came at him and tempted him. And I believe that the fasting and the fasted lifestyle he entered into was a part of that journey to show us how do we deal with hardship? How do we deal with attacks of the enemy? So fasting's a way to do that. Go back and read this at some point. It says that Jesus fasted for 40 days, and then it says, and then he got hungry. I was like, every day I fast, I'm hungry. So I don't know, you know, Jesus obviously being God, but he was fully human, and somehow in that 40-day period, fully reliant on the Father to carry him and the angels to minister to him, he wasn't hungry, which is like mind-blowing and amazing. Moses fasts when he receives the Ten Commandments. He goes up on the mountain, and it says for 40 days he didn't eat or drink. So the Lord supernaturally sustained his body. And Moses trusted that experience. And then Elijah fasts, we see, again, when he comes on the mountain and he receives, in 1 Kings 19:8, it tells us about this, but what's beautiful about this story is that in this moment, God teaches Elijah a new way of doing ministry. And I think because of his fasting, he was able to receive what the Lord had for him, because he went from depression and killing myself to receiving new life and a new mission and a new way of functioning. And so, again, these are absolutely extreme examples. That doesn't mean you're not called into it. But I would say, as I sit with these, I think this is a calling. I wouldn't just enter into a 40-day fast for the reason of entering into a 40-day fast. But when we do, the Lord will meet us and carry us through, as we see in the scriptures, as he does with all those people. The final and fourth thing I want to share with you is that fasting signifies a repentant heart. Okay? So again, fasting breaks us in a way that nothing else can break us. And fasting signifies a repentant heart. We see in the story of Jonah and the Assyrians that they repent with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And God changes his heart and changes his mind. And he relents. The condemnation he was going to pour out on, or the wrath he was going to pour out on Nineveh, he withholds his hand because he sees the response of the people. These aren't even Hebrew people. These are Gentile people outside of God's chosen people. But again, because God loves everybody, He sees the posture of their heart, and they turn to him, and they pray to him, and he holds back. And so we see this beautiful image of fasting that brings about the repentant heart. But this is the last passage I want to share with you, and this is the one that really hit me. And I want to just leave with us as a community of faith, because one of my heart's passion and desires to see the movement of God and the Spirit of God poured out on God's people. And we see that in Joel. So I'm going to show you this verse. It's probably very common to see this. It says, "Afterwards, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those days." And so this is a prophecy that was spoken to by the Lord to Joel, and that Joel put out into the world. Peter picks this up, and he proclaims this in Acts chapter 2, when the Spirit of God is pouring out at Pentecost. And this actually happens and is happening. So this is something that is proclaimed, that has happened then, and it continues to happen now. It's an ongoing prophetic word that the Lord gave to his people, not just at Pentecost, but to continue on for us, the church. And here's, and I think this is absolutely profound and powerful, and I want to see every aspect of this fulfilled, even in this community of faith. But if you back up earlier in chapter 2, you see this verse and this series of verses of what has to happen. It says this, "Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning." So in order to get to the point where the Lord's pouring out his Spirit on his people, this seems to be the qualification that comes up earlier in Joel that says, hey, if you want me to pour my Spirit out on you, I want you to prepare yourself for that and make yourself ready to receive what I have to give to you. And that includes fasting. So it's like, what do I do with that? And the question really becomes, how much of the Lord's presence do you want to carry in your life? How much do you want to be used by God? If the answer is yes, I want to be used by the Lord, or I want more than I have, or I want God to use me in amazing ways, I don't know how to get around the fasting thing. It is what it is. I don't know if I've ever met a man or woman of God that is used profoundly by the Lord who doesn't have a fasted lifestyle in some way. And I know that there's so many, we all have things that go on in our life, and we have medical issues, and I get those things. I get it. But sometimes I feel like, do we trust God? And I'm not saying I want to come over and start your heart again with paddles because you tried to fast and it didn't go well. But I am saying that God is bigger than anything that we can imagine. And can we trust him with even this? Right? We're willing to trust him with other things. Can we trust him with our bodies and our health and our being? So what I want to do is I want to give you kind of just baby steps on how to get started with fasting. Because I would love for fasting to become a thing in our community, a regular part of who we are. And even kind of like if you want to join me on Sunday mornings in fasting, the elders have done that for periods. And I can tell you it makes a difference. You come into this place different with an expectation that you don't normally have when you come filled with food. There's something about not eating and coming into a worship experience that changes you in some way. That's been my experience. And that's been the experience I've heard from others as well. So when you fast for the first time, if you've never done it before, and you start, you decide, okay, Pastor Jimmy's right, the scripture, not really Pastor Jimmy, it doesn't matter what I say, but God's word is right, fasting should be a part of my life. Lord, I want to be used by you in some way. Okay, we're going to start out. When you start out, don't expect the heavens to open and for the Lord to audibly speak to you the first time you fast. That may happen, and it may not, and that's okay. Because again, why do we do it? What do we really want? Do we want the Lord's face? Or are we trying to get something out of him? Because God is not a cosmic vending machine. So we have to be careful as to the reason behind it, the desire behind it. It has to be, Lord, I want you. I want more of you in my life. Okay? And then everything else comes with that, right? Seek first the kingdom of God. And so when you start, be realistic. Okay? A great way to start is to pick one meal in the day and remove it. It might be lunch, it might be breakfast, it might be dinner for you. Just start there. It's a good baby step moving forward. Don't eat lunch. But do it intentionally. There's been times when so I have this regularity of fasting in my life on Wednesdays and Sundays, and there's been times when people are like, hey, would you join me in fasting on a different day? And if my mindset is not right, it's a miserable experience. It's just frustrating. Even though, like, I'm doing it on a regular basis, when sometimes I add it, when I don't, when I'm not in the right place, it'll just be one long fight, and there, it's almost, I feel like there's almost zero benefit to it other than to partner with somebody. So start with a meal, and then start by removing two meals. So don't fast for breakfast, and don't fast for lunch, and then break your fast at dinner. And then go a whole day, right? And what this begins to do is it begins to breed in you a different way of seeing things and holding things and looking at things. And it also brings a reliance on the Lord that you'll begin to experience that's powerful and beautiful and profound. One of the deepest convictions I've had around fasting is Ramadan. I look at the Muslim community because we've had Muslim neighbors, and I watch them go through what they go through. And again, it's frustrating to me because it's pointed in the wrong direction. But yet, it breeds like a powerful movement in them, and you see it. The commitment that they have to do that is honorable. Even though they're heading in the wrong direction and they're worshiping the wrong God, but I see that and I'm like, wow, if they're that committed to their faith, am I that committed to my faith? So it's been a conviction for me personally. And so it inspires me to want to even more chase after the Lord in the same way that they chase after Allah. Okay? So you can fast for a meal, you can fast for an entire day, a 24-hour period. When you do that, I encourage you to, you know, keep liquids flowing. If you need Gatorade, that's okay. It's like you're baby stepping forward into it and you're relying on the Lord. And every time you get hungry or irritable, go to prayer. That's the whole thing. It's like, oh, Lord, I need you. Fasting is a constant reminder that you need the Lord. And let me tell you, that's a beautiful thing to integrate into your life because we need those reminders. Okay? Some of you are living in great hardship and going through hard times. You don't need that reminder. But fasting can bring something else to you, a reminder that God is with you. And sometimes there are situations in our life when we need to discern something's going on, something's hard, or we're praying or interceding for somebody else's behalf. And fasting can be a way that we do that, that builds us up and deepens us in the Lord. I would encourage you to go from one day and then try 2 days. And I'm telling you, day two is so much better than day one. Day one is hard. Day one is frustrating. And sometimes for me on Wednesdays, it's like, I just need to get to bed so that I can get up the next day and I know it's going to be better. And that's not a great way to live life, but sometimes that's how it is, and that's okay. But the entire time, it's a reliance on God. And I want more and more of my life to be more and more reliant on the Lord. And so you can go from 2 days, you can try 3 days, you can try 5 days, 10 days plus. I was reading a book that I heard somebody talk about, a pastor talk about, and I bought it. It was like written in the 50s by a pastor on fasting, and I gave it to Corey to read because I didn't have time. He read it, and I'll go up to Corey because I'll do this every once in a while. I'll be like, hey, how's the book? And he'll just have this smile on his face, and I'll be like, oh, must have said something hard. And then finally I had time to read it, and one of the insights in there that the guy talks about, he's like, yeah, when you're fasting, the real spiritual fruits come after the 10th day. I was like, oh my gosh, come on. Really? I mean, I experience just such encouraging warmth of the Lord in the days that I do it anyway, but at some point I want to extend, I want to get farther and farther in that journey, in that discipline. And because it makes me rely on the Lord more and more. And that's just a good thing. It just is. So I would encourage you to do it with somebody else. It's hard to do on your own. If you have a spouse you could do it with, you have a friend that you could do it with, somebody you're walking with, somebody, a core group that you could do it together and say, hey, let's pick a date and set it aside. And let's go at this together. And we'll encourage each other through the day. And we'll carry each other. And we'll be praying for each other. It's a beautiful act to be a part of something like that. It's a gift. It's a great thing. But at the end of the day, it's an invitation to a greater depth and experience of the Lord. And that's what we want to be about. That's what I want to invite us into. And so I leave it in your hands. This is the teaching of the scriptures. This is another spiritual discipline like many of the others. But in the same way that Jesus said, hey, as my disciples, you need to be praying. He's also saying, you need to be fasting. And so if you haven't been, okay, that's fine. What does it look like moving forward? And like anything else, circle a date on the calendar and kind of go for it. And you'll fail, and you might be frustrated, and that's okay. You get up and you try it again. And like anything else, as you do it more and more, it does get easier and easier. And you push yourself farther and farther. And then in doing that, you rely on the Lord more and more. And it's such a gift. It is such a gift to do. So let me pray for us. Father, thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for our time together. Thank you for the children that we dedicated. We lift them up to you. We're so grateful. Lord, we thank you for these disciplines that were created and formed, that you gave us to teach us how to become more and more like your son, Jesus. And so, Lord, I just pray a blessing over the people of Washington Church. They are here this morning, people who couldn't make it, the people who are worshiping online, Lord, and you would speak to them, and you would invite them into a deeper relationship with you, Lord, that you would bring forward fasting into their life and invite them into a deeper place, Lord. And I pray that as they step out in faith and as they walk with you, they would begin to see the fruit of trusting you in this way, that you would begin to remove the pride that's in our hearts. You begin to expose other things that need to be dealt with, Lord. And then when that happens, Lord, may we lay those down at your feet with repentance. And may you begin to use us in ways that you've never used us. May you reveal yourself to us in ways you've never revealed yourself. And may we have to rely on you more and more, Lord. What a gift that is. So we lift these things up to you. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Would you stand as we partake in the benediction? Just a reminder that we have a connection event. If you're newer to Washington Church or you want to learn more about what we're about and connect with the staff, we'd love to meet with you. In 10 minutes, we'll be out those doors and in a room. You'll see it. If you wander far enough, somebody will flag you down and grab you. The meeting doesn't last too long, but it's a great way to connect with staff, with leadership, to ask questions, to hear about ways you can serve and get more involved. Okay, would you join me in partaking in the benediction together? We are a community of disciples of Jesus Christ, embodying the power and the giftings of the Holy Spirit, cultivating space for healing, and living in and expanding God's kingdom on earth. Amen. Go in peace.